My name is Bob Dahl, and I have the privilege this evening of giving testimony to God's faithfulness and direction in my work life. I've been blessed by a wonderful and challenging career in the investment management business for over 30 years, with early opportunities to be a faithful but quiet witness, mostly by deed, in the hallways and corridors of several large and mostly God-indifferent firms with God-indifferent people. God's been faithful over the years to provide career advancement opportunities and fame and fortune along the way. Through a variety of circumstances and conscious decisions over the last decade, and in particular over the last 5 years, I've become more visible and more vocal about my faith, mostly outside the workplace. With that came abundant blessings and lots of good discoveries, including how many believers there really are out in the marketplace. Parenthetically, I've found that people in agnostic or sometimes God-hostile environments often need someone else to take the lead before they step up and share the fact that they are of faith as well. The testimony that I was asked to share briefly this evening was a bump in my career road last year, a year that I'd prefer not to repeat, but nevertheless one that I wouldn't trade for anything. In May of 2012, I lost my job, ostensibly for sharing my faith. Now, given the persecution that takes place in so many of the countries represented by people in this room, it's almost petty for me to even use that word. And yet, it's indicative of a U.S. culture that is increasingly pagan and one that is slowly denying by omission and even repudiating God at every turn. The loss of job hit me hard as I had unknowingly transferred some of my very identity to my work. And so I felt lost. Who am I without the job? I also, perhaps for the first time in my adult life, had to relinquish control, a great spiritual lesson, especially for a type A male. There are many, many verses that became important to me during these periods. Let me just share a few of them with you, familiar ones. Jeremiah 29:11, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you, not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future." Ephesians 2:10, "For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do." And then the wonderful reminders of Psalm 139, "O Lord, you have searched me and you know me. You know when I sit down, when I rise up, discern my thoughts from afar, my paths, my lying down. You're familiar with all my ways, and before a word is even on my tongue, you know it completely, O Lord." These truths were clear in my head all the way along, but my heart wasn't quite there. It's sometimes said that the longest 12 inches in the world is the distance between the head and the heart. Work, career, position had become a bit of an idol for me. I did come to realize that trusting anything to deliver the control, security, significance, satisfaction, and even beauty that only the true God Jehovah can give is a dead-end alley. And yet for many of us, being productive and doing becomes an attempt at a bit of self-redemption. That is, through our work, as worthy as our work may be, we should not build up our primary worth, security, and meaning in life. That elevated set of characteristics, of course, belongs to the only one who can truly satisfy. To paraphrase Tim Keller, we have all treasures, the things we cherish, delight in, and adore above other things. To understand these idols is to understand the hierarchy of our souls and the foundation of our personalities. Sober truth. To quote the master himself, "For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also." Because we set up idols in our hearts, we recognize that, quote, making an image isn't necessarily a physical process, but certainly a spiritual and, might I say, psychological one. It means turning a good thing into an ultimate thing. The time between jobs gave me a real but gut-wrenching opportunity to deal with clarification of God's calling in my life. Ephesians 4, walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you have been called. And to sense the rich fellowship in prayer and in presence with the body of Christ. I remember vividly on a Saturday morning shortly after I lost my job, moping around the house, wondering out loud, what is God doing? What is God saying? And my wife Leslie came to the rescue and said, would you get your BlackBerry out and review the hundreds of emails you've received of support, prayer, and care, including from some in this room? That's what God is saying. Jesus Christ equipped the saints for the work of the ministry, for building up the body of Christ, Ephesians 4:12. I believe God put me through this experience for lots of reasons, but in part to increase my depth of compassion for others. We need each other. And I'm, with this episode, in a renewed sense, deeply thankful for brothers and sisters in Christ who demonstrated deep caring during those days. I formed a personal board last summer of five guys, all who love the Lord and know me, in order to pray for me, challenge me, hold me accountable, and help carry me to God's next station. And I'm deeply grateful for these men, two of whom are in the hall this evening, for being his ambassadors at my time of need and uncertainty. Now I'm better equipped to be in the marketplace, fully cognizant of whose I am, who is on the throne, and using the workplace as an opportunity to speak in word, deed, and attitude for him. More broadly, as was shared this morning, part of the journey over the years has been to recognize that as a believer, my influence in the workplace is not just to preach the gospel in word and deed for conversion purposes, but much broader than that. I listed three. One, to impact the spiritual lives of believers and non-believers alike. Two, to lead in a way that the principles, values, and ethics of the workplace would be God-honoring. And three, to model work and the workplace as part of God's design and his kingdom. These activities are an honor and privilege and a responsibility of all believers, especially those of us in leadership positions. In part, it's a recognition of these very opportunities and responsibilities that's kept me in the secular marketplace rather than moving to something, quote, in full-time ministry. Those of us in the workplace, as we tried to hammer home in the panel this morning, who name the name of Christ, need to view ourselves and be viewed by others as ministers of the gospel in our places of calling. And as I also mentioned this morning, Billy Graham, among others, has said, the marketplace will be to the gospel in this century what the medical profession was last century. Having been in the workplace for 35 years now and in senior leadership roles for more than half of them, I am convinced that earning the right to be heard on anything, including our faith, starts with being excellent at what we do. Without excellence, who wants to listen to us? Who wants to emulate us? Again, three points. One, we need to have impeccable reputations for finances, caring, and commitment to others. Two, we need to have demonstrated consistent generosity with time and money, often living below our potential lifestyle in order to be financially generous. Three, we especially need to be calm and poised in the face of difficulty or failure. That's when we are watched most carefully. And finally, we need to be identified as Christians in our workplaces, not just blending in. And of course, at the same time, we need to respect and treat others who believe differently as valued equals in the workplace. So in conclusion, God has faithfully brought me from one mountain to a different mountain by crossing through the valley and in the process cutting my compensation by two-thirds. You can laugh, it's okay. I can testify that we learn the most, not only about ourselves, but about our Creator and our Savior in the valleys than we do in the mountaintops. And so may your valleys provide opportunities for you to go deep with him, the one who is sufficient and worthy of our loyalty, our allegiance, and our worship. Amen.